D'accord. OK.
Yes.
So
Okay.
it's great pleasure to have Yosuke Imamura from Tokyo Tech. He's going to tell us about the finite supercoin next year ADS safety response, please.
Okay, thank you for introduction, and thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to talk about my recent work. So today I want to talk about ADS CFD correspondence with finite N. So this work is mainly based on these two papers. Okay, let me start the introduction. So we want to consider ADS CFD correspondence, and let's consider the simplest example. So that is the relation between N equal 4 UN superyamids and type 2B string theory in the ADS5 cross S5 background. And the gauge invariant operator on the gauge theory side corresponded to various objects on the ADS side. So we want to discuss this spectrum of gauge invariant operators. And we use the superconformal index as a mathematical tool to express the BPS spectrum of the gauge invariant operators. So let me define the superconformal index. So first, let's consider a partition function. A superconformal index is a kind of partition function. And the partition function is defined by this equation. Here we consider a sphere partition function defined in this background spacetime. So we consider N equal 4 superyamid theory in four-dimensional spacetime. And we take this spacetime, S3 cross R. And here, so this trace is taken over the Hilbert space of the theory defined in this background. And here, we have H, J1, J2, R1, R2, R3. These are Cartan generators of the PSU2 to bar 4. So this is a superconformal algebra. And H is a Hamiltonian or dilatation. And J1, J2 are angular momenta. And R1, R2, R3 are charges. So this is an element of the symmetry group. And this Z is a function of the variables A, B, C, U1, U2, and U3. And these variables are often called Fugacities. And so this is a partition function. But of course, in general, it is very difficult to calculate this partition function for interacting theories. But it is well known that if you impose this restriction, so this Q is appropriately chosen one specific supercharge. And if this operator anticommute with Q, or equivalently, if we impose this condition on these variables, then we can show that this quantity is independent of the coupling constant. So we can calculate this quantity by using free theory. And the partition function with this restriction is called the superconformal index. So we impose this condition on these variables, and we can use this parameterization. So with this, so instead of A, B, C, and U1, U2, U3, we use Q, Y, and U1, U2, U3. And we can rewrite this partition function in this way. So this is a superconformal index. So we can calculate this quantity on the gauge theory side for an arbitrary N by using localization formula. Okay, so this is a definition. And in this talk, we often turn off variables except for Q to save the space for equations. So in that case, I becomes the function of Q. Okay, so this is a definition of the superconformal index. And the purpose of this talk is propose method to calculate this quantity on the gravity side, on the ADS side. Well, let's call the ADS CFT correspondence. And this, the N is related to the parameters on the ADS side by this relation. Here, L is the ADS radius, and LP is the Planck length. And N is given by this equation. So this means that in the large N limit, this ADS radius is much larger than the Planck length. And classical analysis is justified in this case. So we can reproduce the index by using supergravity in the large N limit. And this is a result of some calculation. So a well-known fact is that the index for the U infinity theory, so large N limit of the index is reproduced as the index of supergravity calcocline modes in S5. So this is S5, and this color represents the some fluctuation of the calcocline modes, the supergravity modes. And you can calculate the large N limit of the index on the gauge theory side by using some saddle point approximation. And the Q expansion gives this result. And actually, this can be reproduced by analyzing these calcocline modes in S5. And this comparison is demonstrated in this paper. And we can find the complete agreement. So this is a story in the large N limit. So now let's consider finite N case. So in this case, we want to know what is the finite N correction on the ADS side. So let's go back to the parameter relation. So this is a parameter relation, and N is written as a ratio of L and LP. So this means, so finite N, if the N is finite, quantum gravity correction becomes important. But we have another relation. So you can, this TD3 is, this is wrong. So the TD3 is D3 Brent tension. Okay. And N, this D3 Brent tension is, so this is proportional to LP to the minus four. So you can write N in this way. So this is the product of TD3 and volume on the, in the ADS space. So this relation implies that finite N correction is produced by extended D3 brains, which is often called giant gravitons. So there are two sources of finite N corrections. And there is an interesting possibility. So if a quantity is protected from quantum gravity correction, then it may be possible to reproduce the finite N correction to the quantity as D3 Brent contributions. And and the supercomer index seems to be such a quantity. So this is an important point. So this is a main claim. So we want to calculate this finite N supercomer index, and it is given by summing up these corrections, contributions. So this is a calcocline mode contribution. This is supergravity contribution. And the second term is a supergravity contribution. And this is a contribution of wrapped D3 brain. So single wrapping D3 brain. And the third term includes the double wrapping D3 brains. And the fourth term includes the triple wrapping D3 brains. And if you sum up all these contributions, then the complete exact index of finite N theory is obtained. This is my main claim in this talk. So we can rewrite this equation in this way. So we can factorize, we can factor out the supergravity contribution. Then this part gives the finite N correction induced by the wrapped G3 branch. So main purpose of this talk is explain how to calculate this correction from the wrapped D3 branch. Okay, so before I explain the how to calculate this part, let me show you some result of numerical analysis. So let's consider N equal one case. Then on the gauge theory side, U1 gauge theory, U1 N equal four U1 gauge theory is just a free theory. So it is quite easy to calculate the index. And this is a result. And on the other side, on the other hand, the supergravity contribution. So as I said, the supergravity contribution agree with the large N limit. And this is a large N limit of the index. So this contribution, this calculation reproduces only four terms. So this part agree. But the fifth term here do not agree to each other. So we have only four terms by using supergravity calculation. So now let's include the wrapped D3 branch contribution. The result is this one. So we calculated single wrapping, double wrapping, and triple wrapping contributions. And we sum up all these contributions. Then we could reproduce all terms shown here. We found complete agreement. So this, I will explain how to calculate this. And unfortunately, I have no proof for the method, but this result is very encouraging. And this formula seems to be correct. Okay. So now this is a plan of my talk. I finished the introduction. And in the next part, I will explain how to construct the formula, how to calculate the index on the ADS side. So this is the main part of my talk. And after this, I give some additional comments, and finally, I summarize my talk. Okay. So now let me explain how to construct the formula. Okay, this is a strategy to get the formula. So we want to calculate the contribution from dynamical D3 branches expanding in the ADS5 cross S5. But this problem is quite difficult. So at first, we consider a reduced system. It is a system of rigid D3 branch. Then this problem is very simple, and we can solve the problem. We can calculate the index for the rigid D3 branch. And the answer is given by wild character formula. I will explain what the wild character formula is later. And finally, to get the answer for the dynamical D3 branch, we do some completion. And then finally, we can get some index formula. Because this part, this completion is based on some guessworks. So So honestly, we do not derive this index formula. That is why I say construction of the formula. This is not a derivation of the formula. Okay. So now let me start to explain this reduction first. Okay, so we want to consider this rebrain expanded in the ADS5 plus S5, and it can fluctuate in the space-time, but this is difficult. So we first neglect the excitation or fluctuations of the brain. That means we consider a rigid D3 brain wrapped in a large circle, large S3 in S5. And let's introduce three complex coordinates, Z1, Z2, and Z3. And let's represent this S5 by this equation. Then this rigid D3 brain, the world volume of this rigid D3 brain is given by linear equation like this. And because we are interested in only in the BPS configurations, this equation must be holomorphic. So we do not use the complex conjugate of Z1, Z2, Z3. So this is most general equation for the BPS rigid D3 brain. And this A, so variable coefficients A, B, and C are a collective coordinate for the rigid motion of this D3 brain. And because overall factor doesn't affect the world volume configuration, so A, B, C coefficients can be regarded as a projective coordinate of CP2. So we can regard rigid D3 brain as a point particle in CP2. So this is just a simple mechanical problem. So we want to consider a point particle in CP2 with coordinates A, B, C. And the quantum state of such particle is described by the wave function on CP2. Actually, this is not just a function, but a section of a line bundle over CP2. And because of Ramon flux, the line bundle is twisted. And actually, the first chunk class of the line bundle is N. And the BPS state is given by a holomorphic section of this line bundle. And it is the general form in such holomorphic section is given by this equation. Here, K1, K2, and K3 are non-negative integers, and they satisfy this constraint. So this is a partition of N to non-negative integers. And for each such partition, we have a state, BPS state of the particle. And this, so these states form a degenerate, so these degenerate states form this representation. So this is a representation of SU3 with Dynkin labels N and zero. This is a symmetric product representation of N fundamental representations. And if N equal one, we have only one state. And if N equal two, N equal one, then the states belongs to the fundamental representation of the SU3. And if N equal two, this belongs to the states forms this representation. And N equal three, we have 10 states in this representation. And this SU3, so this SU3 is a subgroup of the SU4R symmetry. So uh, And this SU4R is the asymmetry of n equal 4 sweet polynomials. And because to define the superconformal index, we have to choose one specific supercharge. And that choice breaks this symmetry into this SU3 symmetry. So we have SU3 manifest symmetry, and the states of rigid D3 blend belong to these representations depending on n. So the partition function of rigid D3 blend is given by the character of this representation. And while the character formula is a formula that gives a character of an irreducible representation of highest weight highest weight irreducible representation of Lie algebra. So it is important to understand the structure of this formula. So let me explain the wild character formula, but before I explain wild character formula, let me point out one important fact. So we have states of rigid D3 brain, and the states form this representation shown as a triangle. And we have three corners. So let's focus on these three states at the corners of triangle. The wave function are given by these functions. And they are, so in CP2, these wave functions give three wave packets localized around a specific three points. And these three points correspond to these D3 brain wrapped around these specific cycles. So this point, this state correspond to D3 brain wrapped around, for example, this cycle. And this state corresponds to this cycle. And this state corresponds to this cycle. And this relation becomes important later. Okay, now let me explain the wild character formula. And let me start from the simplest example. So it is a SU2 case. So let's consider spin S representation of SU2. The spin S representation consists of 2S plus 1 states labeled by the magnetic quantum number. So these are the states. We have 2S plus 1 states labeled by the minus S plus 1, up to S. And the character, the contribution to the character of these states are shown here. So if you have states, so if you have this state, then you replace this to this by Z to M. And by summing up all contributions, then we can get the character. This is a definition of the character. So the sum of these monomials is a character. And you can show, so just you can collect this contribution to this simple fraction. And the wild character formula gives this character as the sum of two contributions. And there is a simple, clear physical interpretation for these terms. So this term, let's first look at this term. So this term, actually this term corresponds to a harmonic oscillator with ground state minus S. So this minus S, so this factor corresponds to the ground state. And you can excite this state by applying the creation operator. So, and Z, this Z corresponds to the creation operator. And by combining all contributions from these excited states, you can get this partition function of this harmonic oscillator. And the other term can also be regarded as the harmonic oscillator, the contribution of harmonic oscillators. So we consider the ground state S, and we consider the creation operator in the opposite direction. So in this harmonic oscillator, the creation operator corresponds to Z to the minus one. Then by summing up all contributions, you can get this partition function. So this is the partition function for harmonic oscillator. So the wild character formula, roughly speaking, the wild character formula gives you the decomposition of irreducible representation into harmonic oscillators. So this is a case of SU2. And actually, this is a case for SU3 case too. So let's consider SU3 representation of this representation. And this is a character given by the wild character formula. So this by using the wild character formula, this represent the character of this representation is given as the sum of three contributions. And you can regard each of them as the partition function of a two-dimensional harmonic oscillators. So for example, look at this term. Let's look at the first term. Then this factor U1 to N, you can regard this as a contribution of ground state. So here, and this factor and this factor, you can regard these two factors as a contribution of two excitations in this direction and in this direction. So if you combine these three contributions, then you can get the character. An interesting point is that the expansion of each contribution gives the infinite series, but if you sum up these three contributions, the result is a finite polynomial. For example, if n equal one, the sum is just one. And if n equal one, the sum consists of only three terms. And if n equal two, you have this polynomial made of six terms.
I have a question? So the character's numerator third term is U3 to the n. This is just type
so
one.
Thank you.
Okay.
This is type four. Yeah, this is three.
Okay, thank you.
Yes. So, and now we want to interpret this equation by using brains, D3 brains. So let's focus on this term. Then, so this term corresponds to this state, this ground state. And this ground state, as I said, this ground state corresponds to this configuration. And here we have two excitations in this direction and in this direction. And they are correspond to two linearly independent motion of this D3 brain. So we can move. So these are this is a rigid one. So we can move in this way or in this way. So this direction or this direction. So we have two linearly independent excitation or two linearly independent deformation of this configuration. they correspond to these two factors. So this is, that's why this is, this corresponds to the two-dimensional harmonic oscillators. And when we describe the Perturbation function for the harmonic oscillator, this this notation is very useful. Here, Px is a plethysmic exponential, and the definition is here. So plethysmic exponential is this. This is an operation that transform excitations to the Perturbation function of the corresponding harmonic oscillator. So if you have x, then so we can regard this as a creation operator. Then we have these excited states. Then we can, the sum is this fraction. So this is the plethysmic exponential of x. And in the fermionic case, we have minus sign. And in this case, the plethysmic exponential is this one. Because this, so this is the index for the fermionic harmonic oscillator that has only two states, ground state and excited state, due to the Pauli exclusion principle. And if you have two harmonic oscillators, then the Perturbation function is just this product. And in general, this plethysmic exponential is defined by this equation. So this Px transform the set of excitations into the corresponding Perturbation function. Okay, so by using this notation, we can rewrite this fraction to the in this way. Okay. So this is a Perturbation function for the rigid D3 brain. So we can give the Perturbation function as the sum of three contributions. And this one, so this term is express the fluctuation around this configuration. And this one is a fluctuation around this configuration. And this one is a fluctuation around this configuration. And to get the complete result, we need to sum up these three configurations. Then we can get the final result, this one or this one. So this is a wild character formula. So wild character formula decomposes this system into three harmonic oscillators, three two-dimensional harmonic oscillators. Okay, this is a summary about the rigid D3 brain, the reduced model. So the index or Perturbation function of the reduced system is given as a sum over three Fox spaces constructed on three vacuum states. And each Fox space is constructed by two harmonic oscillators corresponding to the rigid motions of wrapped D3 brains. Now let's consider how we can get the full index. Actually, our proposal is that the full index is obtained by completions to the ground states and the excitations. Okay. So now let's consider, let's first consider a completion of the excitations. So in the case of rigid D3 brains, we have only two linearly independent motions. So we have two harmonic oscillators. So that gives this Perturbation function. But if the D3 brain is dynamical, there are infinitely many fluctuation modes, including gauge field fluctuation and fermionic excitations. So now let's include all contributions of all fluctuations. So we have infinitely many harmonic oscillators, infinitely many independent excitations. This is obtained by some mode analysis, mode expansion of vector multiplet. on the rapid display plane. Then you can get the corresponding partition function here. So this is the infinite product. So let F3 be this contribution. So now we have three ground states. And for each ground state, we have infinitely many excitations. By combining these contributions, we obtain this index. So we have supergravity contribution, and we have three contribution from wrapped D3 brains. And the interesting point is, so this F3 is independent of N, the rank N. And here the ground state energy, ground state contribution only, so only the ground state contribution depend on N. So now let's consider N equal one case. If we set N equal one, this equation gives this result. So this is the contribution of single wrapping D3 brain. So now let's include this result to the calculation of the index. So we, as I showed you at the beginning of this talk, if you take the only supergravity contribution, then it reproduces only four terms correctly. But if you include this contribution, the result is this one. Then we have 12 terms correctly reproduced. So we find a big improvement. So this is very encouraging result. But we need more correction to reproduce this part. So this part doesn't match. So we need more completion to the formula. So in the next step, so we consider completion of the ground states. So in the previous calculation, we included only three ground states, and each ground state corresponds to a single D3 brain, single wrapped D3 brain, wrapped around specific three cycles. But now let's include arbitrary number of D3 brain. So this is a general situation. So we have N1 D3 brain wrapped around this cycle, and N2 D3 brain wrapped around this cycle, and N3 D3 brains wrapped around this cycle. Then on each cycle, we have UN gauge group. And if you combine these three cycles, then this gauge, so Kuiper gauge theory is realized on this brain system. And at the intersection, we have hypermerge breadth from open strings connecting these two cycles. So on this brain configuration, we have this Kuiper gauge theory is realized, and we can calculate the index of this Kuiper gauge theory. So now let's sum up all the contribution from these Kuiper gauge theories. So this, for the single wrapping case, in the single wrapping case, we have three contributions. So these numbers are wrapping. So this configuration is labeled by three wrapping numbers, N1, N2, and N3. And they become a rank of these gauge groups. And the simple case, we have only one, if we have only one D3 brain, So we have three cases, three Kleber gauge theory. That is just a U1 gauge theory. And for the double wrapping configuration, we have six Kleber gauge theories. And each of them are calculated by using some localization formula. And the triple wrapping configuration contribution is given as a sum over 10 Kleber gauge theories shown here. So now we can calculate the index of each Kleber gauge theories, and we can sum up all contribution. Then this is a result. So this is a result I showed you at the beginning of this talk. So we can reproduce all terms shown here by summing up the first three G3 brain corrections. And actually, by summing up these contributions, we can match the result up to this order, Q to the 13, for n equal 1. But actually, it is very difficult to calculate, for example, this contribution. And to calculate this one, I used a supercomputer at our institute. And it took about a few days. But anyway, so we could reproduce all terms here. So now let me summarize the formula.
So, sorry, above formula,
yes.
U1 case.
U1 case is, so if n equal larger than 1,
yes.
Then, so n appear only here.
Uh-huh.
This is better. So this is general formula.
Yes.
And this is supergravity contribution, and uh-huh. this is a contribution from Kleber gauge theories.
Uh-huh.
And n1, n2, n3 are non-negative integers. And uh-huh. this factor is a contribution of ground state.
Uh-huh.
This is related to the brain tension and R charge of wrapped brain. Uh-huh. And this F is the index of the Kleber gauge theory.
Oh, I see.
And the N dependence, capital N dependence appears only in this factor.
I see.
So it is very easy to change this N.
I see. Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah. And so, yeah, so this is general formula I propose in this paper. And the supergravity contribution is this well-known factor. And this is, as I said, this is the contribution of Kleber gauge theory realized on the world volume of wrapped D3 brains. And to get this formula, we did the two-step completion. But this completion was based on some guessworks. So unfortunately, we have no proof at present. But as far as we have checked numerically, this formula works quite well. Okay, so now I finished the main part of my talk. So do you have any question? So this is my main claim.
So, okay.
Yes.
Essentially, so in addition to supergravity, you use Kleber gauge theory of D3
brains. Yes.
I see.
Yes.
So once you have like a description for this kind of like a finite any contribution, any dimension, you can write down is in principle.
Yes.
Index for any dimension, any supercomma index, if you have such a description in gravity side.
Yes. For example, let's consider 3D case.
Yes.
In this case, on the gauge theory side, we have ABJM theory. And this is the holographic dual of this system is ADS 4 × S7.
Uh-huh.
And the finite end collection is given by M5 brain wrapped around this S7. Uh-huh. So M5 brain,
I see,
wrapped around S5 in this S7.
Yep.
So if you can calculate the index for this M5 brain, then uh-huh. you can calculate this one.
Oh, I see.
But actually, it is difficult to calculate this one because okay. this is non-Lagrangian.
Yeah, I see.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah. Okay, so now let me give some comments, additional comments. The first comment is about the contribution of this one. So this is a single wrapping contribution. So this one, these contributions. And this is contribution from the wrapped D3 brain. D3 brain wrapped around S3 in S5. But actually this is the same as a U1 index. So this U1 is a boundary theory. And this is because, so when you consider a superconformal index, you consider the world, the top background geometry S3 cross R. And the finite end collection is also given as a wrapped D3 brain with world volume S3 cross R. So you can rewrite, you can get this correction from this index by simple variable change. So essentially, so this correction is the same as the index of the gaze on the gaze theory side. Okay. And the second comment is about the tachyonic mode. So we consider D3 brain wrapped around S3 in S5, but the cycle, the three cycle is not topologically, it is topologically trivial. So you can unwrap the D3 brain by continuous deformation. So that means you have a tachyonic excitation on the D3 brain world volume. And that appear here as a term with negative exponent of Q. So exponent of Q is, roughly speaking, it is energy. So this term corresponds to negative energy fluctuation. It is a tachyonic mode. But existence of such mode, such term is natural because the three cycle is topologically trivial. And one interesting point is a precistic exponential formally gives a negative contribution, negative factor for around Q equals zero in the Q expansion around Q equals zero. And this prescription works well. So if you do, so this negative contribution gives the correct, negative factor gives the correct answer, but physically, interpretation is not clear. So treatment of this tachyonic term is problematic. And there is some, yeah, it is some interpretation is not clear. Okay. And the next comment is about this one, the partition function or the index of the Quiver gauge theory on the wrapped brain. And to calculate this one, we use some localization formula. So this can be obtained as a matrix integral of some function. And usually the integration contour, we take the unit circle as an integration contour. But in this case, we cannot do that because of the existence of the tachyonic term. So existence of tachyonic term implies that the pole position is unusual. So the pole selection rule should be modified. So it is, yeah. So if you want to calculate the high, so multiple wrapping contribution, you need to, so you need you need to decide some non-trivial pole selection rule. And I proposed in the recent paper, a rule, the pole selection rule for SU N equal 4 super M in this case. Okay.
And so
next, yes.
This is not usually a supercomputer index, you just do the Taylor expansion and then Taylor expansion. Look at the constant term. Do the, but your pre-exclusion is a bit different to get the pole.
Yeah, so if you have tachyonic term,
yes,
then some convergence region so is different. So we so this is a specific exponential.
Uh-huh.
So if you have X inverse here,
uh-huh,
then it doesn't converge around X equals zero.
I see.
So that is a problem.
I see.
Yeah.
I see. Okay, thank you.
Okay, so. And the next comment is about the recent work by Guyot and Lee. And they found similar expansion in this paper by the analysis on the gauge theory side. So this is their expansion, giant gravity. They call this giant graviton expansion. And this is very similar to our expansion, but they are not the same. For example, this expansion is a simple expansion over index n, but our expansion is a triple expansion over three wrapping numbers as here. So it's summation over three wrapping numbers. So this expansion, so Guyot-Lee expansion and our expansion are very similar, but different. So I don't, unfortunately, at present, I have no clear explanation about the relation between these two expansions, but yeah, it would be very important to clarify the relation between two expansions. Yeah, I think so, yeah. And finally, let me comment on application to other systems. So in this talk, I focus on this example, the simplest example of ADS5 cross S5 and N equal 4 super MUs. But as you know, so there are many examples of ADS50 correspondence. And so these are examples. And my collaborators and I applied the similar method to these examples. And in all cases, we obtain the result that are consistent with known result. Yeah, so our method is applicable to the very large class of examples. So now let me summarize my talk. So we proposed a new method to calculate the index of N equal 4 super MUs on the ADS side. So I want to emphasize this part. Our analysis is on the ADS side. And although we have no proof at present, the numerical analysis showed it reproduces the correct answer. And the method has been applied to many examples of ADS50 correspondence and it seems to work well. And due to the technical problem about the pole selection rule, about the pole selection in the contour integral, it is very hard to calculate the multiple wrapping contributions. So yes. And finally, similar expansion was recently proposed by Guyot and Lee based on the analysis on the Gaisser result. So their analysis is based on the Gaisser result. So, and they get very similar expansion, but a little bit different. So it is very interesting to understand the precise relation between their expansion and ours. Okay, now I finish here. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you very much for nice talk. Any question from audience? Do you have some any comment on recent development of this like a Bekenstein Hawking entropy formula out of supercomputer index, like a whatever, so, like a King College group or like a SOC game and so on?
Yeah. So ADS black hole. Black hole. The entropy of ADS black holes is recently reproduced by using the index.
Yep.
But in their analysis, so in the discussion of black hole entropy, the important region is so this region, so energy comparable to n square. But our expansion gives the correction around this region. So this is order, so Q to N, and this is order Q to N square.
I see.
So yeah, these two analyses look at a different region, different parameter region, but so it is very important to check this expansion. So whether this expansion can be extended to this region or not.
I see.
But actually this, our formula works even for n equal one.
Uh-huh, yes. So
in that case, this is the same as this one.
Uh-huh.
So I hope our expansion can cover this region.
I see. Uh-huh. Any other question from audience?
Hello, I want to ask one question.
Yes.
Is there some similar like phase transition like the Hagedorn transitioning in your setup?
Actually no. So because we consider so this region, so we cannot see any some phase transition. So probably to see a phase transition, we need to take the large a kind of Lagrangian limit.
Yes. So Lagrangian limit is difficult to be taken in this region.
Yes. So if you take the Lagrangian limit to in our expansion, then you can get just the supergravity result.
Yes.
In the Lagrangian limit. So if you take the Lagrangian limit, so this becomes only n equals zero term contribute to this index. So in the Lagrangian limit, you get this result.
Yes.
So in this case, you only see the supergravity contribution.
I'm wondering if like the subleading term will also well, play a role in this Hackathon phase transition.
I think it is interesting problem.
Uh-huh.
But sorry, I have nothing to say.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Any other? I have one more. So 40 n equals to 3, is there any result you can compare?
Yes, actually.
Yeah, 40 n equals to 3. There is no Lagrangian description, but can
choose. N equals 3, yeah, this one.
Yeah.
And when we wrote this paper,
uh-huh.
we checked the correctness of our result by using supersymmetry enhancement to n equal 4.
Oh.
So if rank is very small,
uh-huh.
it is known that, so it is pointed out by, so it was pointed out by Tachikawa and Haruni and Tachikawa,
yeah.
that this n equal 3 symmetry is enhanced to n equal 4.
I see.
And we checked the index
mm-hmm.
of n equal 3 theory with rank 1 and 2
uh-huh.
agree with the index of n equal 4 theory.
That was
one consistency check.
I see.
And later, some UV description of some of n equal 3 theories are proposed by Lazamat.
I see.
And he calculated the index, and that was also consistent with our result.
I see. Uh-huh. Wonderful. And can you, how to say, like refine your index? Like usually 40 n equal to 4, you have a P and a Q or a T or something parameter you can
today.
You only focus on like a sure limit, maybe? Only Q?
No. The most general one.
Most general one? Oh, okay.
Yes, this one. But
a different to way.
Space okay. of equations. I only show you only the Q expansion, but you uh-huh. can turn on these parameters.
You can turn on. I see. You can turn on.
Yes.
I see. Uh-huh. So then is any some like a sure or McDonald limit of this 40 n equal to 3?
40 n equals 3?
Like a sure or McDonald limit of
So because we can calculate the most general super conformal index, you can take uh-huh. the limit, like a sure limit of McDonald limit. Yeah.
Uh-huh. I see. Does it match with like a chiral algebra and so on?
Yes. So we can calculate the sure index and it we can
compare with the, I see, interesting, very interesting.
Yeah, thank you.
Any other question from audience? I think it's a very fantastic result.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay, if not, let's thank the speaker again.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yep. So I will post a video on the YouTube soon. And then no question.
I have one mistake. So about n equals 3 results. I said Lazamat gets some result, but that was incorrect. That is Zafril.
Zafril. Okay.
Yeah, Zafril. Yeah.
Okay. I see.